Guess which artist lived with his mom most of his life, was obsessed with Hollywood and ice cream, bald as a bat but loved crazy wigs, and loved to cover everything in aluminum foil? Yep, it's Andy Warhol. You intrigued? So was I.
This episode is funded by the Glick Fund and the Crystal DeHaan Family Foundation, who inspire philanthropy and creativity.
Warhol was born Andrew Warhola in 1928 in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, to Julia and Andre Warhola. Both his parents were Czechoslovakian immigrants who worked incredibly hard to get here. The couple had three sons, Paul, John, and Andrew, the youngest. Andy was moody, prone to panic attacks, and rather shy. In fact, while in grade school, Andy once refused to return to school after a female student slapped him. His mom, Julia, who loved how dependent Andy was on his mama, pulled Andy out of school for the next 2 years. Even though Julia was a bit of a helicopter mom, she was a bit of an artist herself. She could be found putting flower arrangements together in Campbell's soup cans, which also happened to be Andy's favorite lunch. You better believe that resurfaced later. Even when Andy was at school, he was often homesick due to a nervous system disorder which caused his skin to change color and give him a fever. Interestingly, it was while homesick Andy started listening to the radio, sketching and collecting lots of 8x10 glossies of movie stars, a hobby he later said helped define his career. He was especially obsessed with Shirley Temple. After graduating high school, Andy attended the School of Fine Arts at Carnegie Institute, now known as Carnegie Mellon University. Even though he appeared weak and quiet, Andy would apparently outperform the other students in his art assignments. The quiet art ninja you never see coming. To make extra money, Andy's brothers would sell produce from the back of a truck, while Andy would make quick portraits of customers for 25 cents a pop. Check out this sweet contour drawing. Andy definitely realized how to turn art into cash. In 1949, Andy exhibited a painting in the Pittsburgh Association of Artists, playfully called Nose Picker. The actual title was, "The Broad Gave Me My Face, But I Can Pick My Own Nose." You gotta love that. The jury couldn't decide if it was groundbreaking or just dreadful. In the end, it was rejected, but earned Andy some good street cred in the art world. Just before graduating in 1949, Andy considered becoming a high school art teacher. In fact, he put his resume in for a job here in Indiana, but didn't get the job. It was during this same year Andy's friend Philip Perlstein convinced him to move to New York. On his second day in the city, he snagged a commission for Glamour magazine. When the art director asked him what he could draw, Andy says, "I can draw anything." I love his response. It was also during this time that Andy dropped the A off his given last name of Warhola when an article he illustrated made a typo and dropped it. Andy liked it, so he went with it. Andy quickly became one of the most sought-after commercial artists in New York, with magazines such as Glamour, Vogue, and Vanity Fair wanting his designs. Andy would make the rounds with clients during the day and sketch late into the night. Then, his assistants would transfer the designs onto another sheet. This created that distinctive blotted line design everybody loved, which earned him design awards, contracts, and a lot of cash. It was right about this time that Andy's mom, Julia, decided to move to New York in his basement apartment off 75th Street, and then to a townhouse off Lexington Avenue to look after Andy. Apparently, Julia and Andy loved them some kitty cats since they had several living with them. According to friends, maybe a bit too many, since they reported the place often smelled like cat pee. Kitty cats. But hey, they somehow worked it out since they were roommates for 20 years, cat pee and all. In 1957, Andy was doing so well, he started Andy Warhol Enterprises Incorporated. But as the fashion world went in a different direction, Andy's business empire started falling apart, and he scrambled to find more commissions to keep up his swanky lifestyle. But a significant change was happening in the art world, as things shifted away from abstract expressionism. Artists such as Jasper Johns and Robert Rauschenberg were now getting their chance to show in a big gallery, and Andy saw an opportunity. Andy 2.0 was not going to just be an illustrator, but an accomplished artist. His goal was to exhibit at Leo Castelli Gallery, but he often had shows at the Serendipity 3 restaurant, which was also his favorite stop for frozen hot chocolate. In fact, we had a chance to go sit down with the owner, Stephen Bruce, who helped put on these art shows for Andy, and told us about his friendship with him. And yes, I tried the frozen hot chocolate. It was epic. It was awesome. Warhol was now a commercial artist by day and a painter by night. His first pop art painting advertisement was a collage of ads for food, fitness, and facial surgery. But the real breakthrough happened after Warhol painted two different Coke bottle paintings. One was more abstract, and the other simply had clean line design. He invited filmmaker Emile D'Antonio over to check them out. Emile simply tells him, the abstract one is crap, the other one is remarkable. Destroy the first one and show the other. Needless to say, he took the advice. In comes the 60s, along with Andy's new persona, a tough makeover, complete with leather jacket, jeans, sunglasses, ankle boots, and a messy wig. Oh, and just in case you didn't know, Andy started going bald pretty early, so his way of embracing it was changing out crazy wigs often. I gotta love the approach. Now that he had the art world's attention, he wanted to keep his momentum, but wasn't sure what to do next. It was while hanging out with gallery owner Marielle Leto that he paid her $50 to tell him what should he paint next. Marielle asked him one simple question. What do you love? Andy answered with Campbell's soup and money. Good use of $50. It was in 1962 at the Ferris Gallery, Warhol hung 32 of his Campbell's soup cans. He hung them around the gallery to resemble a grocery store. This show completely challenged the public's idea of what a valid art subject was. Soon after this show, pop art hit big. Artists such as Roy Lichtenstein and Klyas Oldenburg were leading the way and were infamously called the New Realists. These artists were gathering ideas from pop culture, cars, comics, and celebrities, hence the term pop art. In 1964, Warhol went for it and purchased a former factory on Union Square. He hired Billy Lynch to decorate the entire space in silver. Warhol then filled the walls of the factory with faux food boxes resembling grocery store walls. It was in autumn of 64 that Warhol had a show called Flowers at the Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris, where he fills the walls with over 400 paintings. Serial imagery to the extreme. It was after this show that Warhol announced he was retiring from painting and going into film. Of course, like an NBA superstar, that retirement, it didn't last too long. Warhol's film career was one of the most fascinating, bizarre, and, well, highly controversial. The main aspect of many of his films was playing with time. For example, his film Empire is 6 full hours of the iconic skyscraper as it disappears into the night. Now, my personal favorite is Andy simply eating a hamburger. Nonetheless, he definitely developed a cult following for his films, and even won some awards. Unfortunately, in 1968, playwright Valerie Solanas walked into the factory and shot Warhol in a stunt to promote her new play. Yeah, she took it a bit too far. After 6 hours of surgery, Andy literally came back from the dead. Jumping ahead into the 70s, Warhol found himself once again in Paris at the opening of Centre de Pompidou. Warhol returned home super inspired with new energy and a desire to paint. For years, Warhol pushed against abstract expressionism, but this time he decided to give it a go. He created what he calls his oxidation paintings, where he tested chemical reactions using the acid in urine with a variety of metal paints. Bet you didn't see that one coming, did you? Warhol would have his assistants eat a bunch of vitamin B and tell them not to pee before they came to the factory. Then the painting began. Pretty interesting, right? Just a year after, in 1987, Warhol was commissioned to create a series of religious paintings, which are actually some of my favorite pieces, especially his take on the Last Supper. Unfortunately, it was this same year that Warhol went in for gallbladder surgery. He had started to make a good recovery. However, due to an irregular heartbeat, he died in his sleep at the hospital on February 22nd at the young age of 58. Andy Warhol was a master artist and a huge collector. In fact, after his death, it took Christie's 10 days to auction off all his collectibles, bringing in over 20 million bucks. As for his paintings, they still remain some of the most sought-after artworks in the entire world. In fact, in 1963, Silver Car Crash Double Disaster went for 105 million bucks. While often misunderstood, Warhol was one of the most amazing individuals who loved family and loved the power of creativity. He knew how to capture the culture of his day and present it in a way that made us all stop, think, and experience our world differently.
Hey, did you know that subscribing to our channel is one of the most epic things you can do? That's right. Subscribe now, share our episodes, so that we can actually make more of these things. I'm not gonna lie. I love showing you where creativity and innovation are happening. Get on board and be outrageous.